What if lions were introduced to Australia? You can find big cats all over the world. The Americas have cougars and jaguars. Africa has lions and cheetahs. Asia has tigers and leopards. But when you look at Australia, they have no big cats, none. So what would happen if we introduced a big cat there? Not just any big cat, one of the most feared predators on the planet, the lion. Would it throw Australia's whole ecosystem off? How would the lions fare in a new world? And what would it mean for all of the native species already there? Australia. Let's start with that land down under known as Australia. We already mentioned how none of the big cat species are there. That means no tigers, lions, jaguars, leopards, snow leopards, cheetahs, or cougars. There's not even any lynxes or caracals or ocelots. There were reports of American soldiers arriving in Australia during World War II and having brought cougars and panthers with them as mascots, and perhaps those big cats being let out into the wild, but they are not native to the region. If this did happen, the numbers were limited, and no one believes there's still a population of them existing today. No, in Australia, they just have feral cats. Now, that's not to say there aren't many species of animals living in Australia. In fact, Australia hosts some of the most unique species in all of the world, due to its isolation from the rest of the continents. You probably know Australia as the world of kangaroos and wallabies and wombats and koalas, and that's true. Australia is home to many unique mammals. In fact, it is the only place that is home to all three types of mammals, which are placentals, monotremes, and marsupials. Australia also has many predators, like the dingo, the only canine on the continent. There are dozens of snakes and enormous venomous spiders that, if we told you the actual number, it would make your skin crawl. Not to mention the continent is replete with crocodiles. Both freshwater crocodiles and saltwater crocodiles live in Australia, so no water is safe. Then again, they're really only found in northern Australia, as the farther south you go below the equator, the cooler the climate can get. Crocodiles prefer to be able to stay near the water and stay in the heat. Heat is something you can get plenty of in Australia. It's quite close to the equator, the northernmost parts at about 9 degrees south, and then reaching down to about 44 degrees south, where it can get cooler. That is why Australia has vastly different landscapes all around. There are tropical rainforests, there are mountain ranges, and then there is the outback. The desert or semi-arid portion right in the center of Australia. The outback is enormous, and it is notoriously dry. In fact, it brings down Australia's whole average, making it the driest continent in the world. The outback is also fairly uninhabited, with just about 3.4 inhabitants per square kilometer, which is about 0.6 square miles. So for every square mile in the outback, you shouldn't expect to even see 7 people. Most of the continent's population lives along or near the coasts, as those are the areas that are more inhabitable for the human race. Then again, we're not thinking about moving humans here. We're thinking about moving lions here. So let's see about wrangling up some lions and preparing them for the move. Africa. But if we are going to wrangle up some lions, carefully I might add, we have to know where to find them. It's fairly common knowledge that lions live in Africa. So, let's take a trip to the continent of Africa and see what we are getting ourselves into. Now, Africa is similar to Australia in many respects. One, there are many different habitats with tropical rainforests and mountainous regions and deserts as well. And Australia's northernmost points were quite close to the equator. Well, the equator runs right through the center of Africa. And when we look at the regions that lions live in, they are primarily in sub-Saharan Africa, meaning they avoid that gigantic desert. But the areas they live in aren't exactly moist or humid or tropical. They live in a lot of savannas and grasslands and even arid plains, so they're no stranger to dry heat. They can also be found in mountainous regions, being located as high up as 11,800 feet on Mount Elgon on the border of Uganda and Kenya, and even near the snow line on Mount Kenya. Lions, however, will not enter closed forests, not a habitat that they prefer. So their range is just about 15 degrees north to 30 degrees south, which shows us they are used to the heat. In fact, they thrive in the heat. The areas in which lions live rarely drop below 68 degrees, even in the coldest months, and they're used to constant 80 to 86 degrees during the daytime and limited rainfall in the dry months. Due to these factors, they like to be near a constant water source, but they also want to have plenty of shade available. They spend a lot of time out in direct sunlight, so they need to be able to escape it when they need to. Another thing they like is plenty of cover, like bushes and tall grasses. That has less to do with the temperature, though, and it has more to do with hunting. Killer lion. To call a lion a killer is obviously not hyperbole. They have to hunt to eat and to stay alive. They are carnivores, big carnivores, so they need to eat big meals. Lions typically are between 6 and 8 feet long, gigantic muscular felines that weigh anywhere between 350 and 500 pounds when fully grown. So, how do you quell the hunger of a 500-pound carnivore? Lots of big mammals for starters. Big-hoofed animals are a lion's favorites, such as zebras, gazelles, antelopes, and buffaloes. These animals are ideal because they could weigh anywhere between 500 to 2,000 pounds, and a lion is not only large, but he has a pride to feed. A lion's pride could have anywhere from 6 to 10 to 15 or even more lions in it. So bigger animals are preferred when your family sits down to the dinner table and they are over a dozen in numbers. Then again, if lions need to, they'll feast on a number of smaller animals like warthogs, turtles, birds, hares, lizards, and mice. It isn't ideal. If they catch one lizard or one hare, that might just be a small lunch for one lion. Now, lions form a pride, which will consist of the young, the females, and the males. The adult males in the lion pride are what's known as the coalition. The females tend to do more of the hunting, and the males do more of the protecting. Protecting of both their land and their family. Lions have to deal with other predators in the area trying to horn in on their grounds and their kills. This can include hyenas, leopards, cheetahs, African wild dogs, and other lions. Now, lions don't have too much trouble with these other predators that we mentioned. They're larger than all of them, and they're stronger than all of them. Their powerful jaws exert a bite force of around 650 pounds per square inch, and they can sprint up to 45 or even 50 miles per hour. No one is sneaking up on the ever-vigilant lion, and if they manage to sneak in, steal some food, and run off, not many are outrunning that lion. If we are talking about an all-out sprint, the 36-mile-per-hour leopard, the 40-mile-per-hour hyena, and the 44-mile-per-hour African wild dog won't get away. The cheetah is the only one outrunning the lion, but he better know that he isn't close enough to those big paws, because the lion is the apex predator, and he rules his grounds with ferocity. The one animal the lion has to be wary of is the crocodile. There are plenty of West African slender-snouted crocodiles and Nile crocodiles in Africa, so lions are well aware of them. Nile crocodiles have ferocious bites, 5,000 psi for their bite force. Lions have learned to go near the water for a drink, cautiously, and keep away at other times. They never let their guard down, because if a crocodile was feeling territorial and decided to attack, there's a battle that could go either way. But it's good that the lions are well versed in the language of crocodile. They'll need to speak that language where they're going. So let's grab that pride of lions, it's about 12 of them, and let's bring that dirty dozen down under. A southeast excursion. We've got the pride of 12 lions and we're heading southeast, crossing the Indian Ocean in our plane and dropping off the precious and deadly cargo. So our pride of lions has arrived in Australia. It's a new land for them, but as they begin to adjust, they'll slowly start to realize there are a lot of areas just like home. There are tropical rainforests that they'll likely avoid like they do back in Africa, but there are mountainous areas, there are open plains, and there is the outback, along with many of the surrounding areas around the outback. That all looks quite similar to the savannas and grasslands and semi-arid regions back in Africa. Another similarity, not so many people living in a lot of these parts. That is also ideal, and just like much of the lands that lions occupy back home, so far it's looking quite good. The more the lions investigate these areas, they can find their water sources. They can find some cover for hunting, they can find some shade, and wait a second. Hold on, do you hear that? That's the sound of no other big cats in the area. Lions were already used to being the apex predator, but they did still have a lot of hungry competition, other predators killing and eating prey animals before they had a chance to. Out here, no other felines to compete with, no hyenas, and the dingoes are similar to the African wild dogs, but that is about 25% less competition for our pride of lions. That makes things a lot easier. Now, for predators that dominate the water and also come out into land, of course, there are the crocodiles. They're trading out the slender, snouted and Nile crocs for freshwater and saltwater crocs. The lions will have to move even more cautiously around these reptiles, but luckily, they have had a lot of practice. So, what's the problem? They can live here, they can avoid the crocs, they have less competition. So, where are all the large prey animals? And there lies a tiny issue. The lions' favorite meals, large hoofed animals, there are none in Australia. That's right, not one wild hoofed animal in Australia. They just don't exist there. In fact, because Australia broke away from other continents so long ago, many placental animals had not yet fully developed, so there aren't a ton of these types of animals. There just happens to not be a lot of large animals that the lion would consider prey. For the lion pride, their best bets would probably be wallabies, wombats, koalas, birds, and lizards. Those are around the size of the smaller animals that lions would eat back home, but again, not their preference. Those are enough to be a meal for one, not the whole pride. That means the lions will really have to work hard for their meals. They may not be able to hunt and share. It might be more like hunt and this one is all mine. There are feral pigs that are a bit larger, and kangaroos. But that's a difficult one. Some kangaroos are big, and they put up a fight. Quite literally, they punch. The lions may not enjoy hunting an animal that fights back, but they may have to tough it out and hunt down the kangaroos anyway. Regardless, there's nothing like zebras and buffaloes and the like. So there's a very good chance that our lions will end up adapting after moving here. If this pride of lions continues to mate and thrive and exist for years and decades and centuries, people will speak of lions for years to come. The lions of Africa, 7 feet long, 500 pounds, they're far larger than their cousins in Australia. Yes, because the Australian lions didn't have large animals to feed on, so they shrunk over time. We might be looking at lions that are only about 4 to 5 feet long, only 250 pounds. They'll still be the biggest cats in Australia. They'll be the only big cats in Australia. Those crocodiles will start looking a lot larger, a lot scarier. But lions could survive Australia. They would just have to adapt. And as for all the small marsupials, they'll have to adapt because they'll have just acquired a new predator. And those kangaroos, they better adapt and develop a mean right cross because they'll need it.